Oh, that's so many mosquitoes. Oh, I'm just getting itchy looking at that many mosquitoes.
Right now, we are producing mosquitoes for a project in the third largest city in Colombia called Cali. And we are sending around 17,000 tubes, 4.5 million mosquitoes per week.
Per week?
Per week.
Human footprint has taken me to some weird places, but I never thought I'd see the inside of a mosquito factory. For that matter, I never imagined that was even a thing. But here in Colombia, they're breeding and releasing mosquitoes by the millions. And the science behind why blew my mind. I'm Shane Campbell-Staton, and this is Human Footprint.
If you're bitten by any mosquito here, you're not gonna get any disease. This is the safest place of Colombia for being bitten by a mosquito.
This is Nelson Grisales. He never misses a chance to take his wife salsa dancing in the nightclubs of Medellín. By day, Nelson's a medical entomologist focused on preventing mosquito-borne diseases.
Mosquitoes kill more people in the world than any other animal. Right now, we have in the Americas more than 10 million cases of dengue this year.
Dengue, also known as breakbone fever, is a devastating viral disease that's endemic to tropical regions around the world. And it's becoming more common as the world grows warmer and more urban every year. In 2024 alone, dengue killed over 10,000 people and infected 14 million. It's transmitted by a mosquito called Aedes aegypti, which can also carry yellow fever, Zika, and chikungunya.
Exactly what is a vector?
So a vector is an organism that can transmit a disease from one host to another.
And the way mosquitoes share pathogens with us, you're not gonna like it.
People think that they are only suckers. They only suck.
Okay.
That's not true. First, they inject anticoagulant. They inject analgesic, so you don't feel they are biting you. They're not only sucking your blood, they're also basically spitting in your blood.
It was gross before, and I didn't appreciate it, and now it's grosser.
But what if we could stop dengue transmission from mosquitoes to humans? That's what Nelson and his colleagues at the World Mosquito Program are trying to do.
We do not control mosquitoes. We use a bacterium called Wolbachia that is present in more than 50% of the insects described.
In other words, over half of all insect species have these Wolbachia bacteria living inside their cells. Now, Aedes aegypti doesn't have its own strain of Wolbachia, not in nature anyway. But when researchers infected them with Wolbachia from fruit flies in the lab, they discovered something pretty amazing.
When Wolbachia is inside the mosquito cannot transmit very effectively all of these arboviruses.
So a mosquito carrying Wolbachia can bite a dengue-infected human without transmitting the virus to its next victim.
The scientists realized they could be looking at a way to stop dengue in its tracks, but only if the bacteria would spread in a wild mosquito population. Wolbachia isn't contagious like a cold. Instead, mothers pass it to their offspring through the egg.
But Wolbachia has another trick up its, I want to say flagellum? It's something called cytoplasmic incompatibility. Basically, these bacteria can change how mosquitoes reproduce.
Infected females produce infected young, whether their mate was infected or not. Uninfected females mating with infected males don't produce any young at all. So with every generation, a greater proportion of the mosquitoes carry Wolbachia until the whole population is infected.
The program's goal is to trigger this bacterial chain reaction by releasing huge numbers of Wolbachia-infected mosquitoes. They mass-produce the mosquitoes in this biofactory, from eggs to aquatic larvae to flying, biting adults.
Male mosquitoes are happy to eat sugar water, but the females, they're out for blood.
Theoretically, if I were in there, how long would it take before I looked like a mummy?
I would say the mosquitoes are hungry, no more than an hour.
No one's gonna volunteer for that job. So Nelson and the team feed the females with blood donated by local blood banks.
They are furious. They are really going at it.
After a hearty meal, the females lay eggs and the cycle repeats.
Once we have the eggs, then those dry eggs can be swept, put into capsules with a little bit of food, and then shipped to any other country that needs it.
This one facility can produce 30 to 40 million eggs per week. Today, the World Mosquito Program is working in more than a dozen countries. And that means convincing local communities that a solution to their mosquito problem is releasing more mosquitoes.
The beauty of this is that we explain to people, look, we only want to have 20 weeks of releases. And after those 20 weeks, your community is going to be protected for decades.
On the ground, that outreach is led by local community workers, like Mayuri Betancourt.
Es muy loco porque siempre nos han dicho el mosquito no, ese mosquito es malo. Entonces decir que vamos a liberar el mosquito fue como cierto, no es lo normal. Entonces, pero ya después de que entendimos cómo era que funcionaba, dijimos, yo quiero ser parte de eso.
Gaining the community's trust meant full transparency about the project's goals and its methods.
Hicimos varias idas a la biofábrica para que ellos vieran todo el proceso, desde que el mosquito, pues como lo hacíamos todo eso allá, y que ellos pudieran comprenderlo bien. No tuvimos ningún barrio donde dijeran, no, aquí no.
Today, the communities involved are seeing results. Colombian cities where Wolbachia-infected mosquitoes were released have far fewer lab-confirmed dengue cases. And in 2021, a larger randomized study in Indonesia found that releasing the mosquitoes reduced the chance of a person contracting dengue by 77%.
So the World Mosquito Program looks like a success story, but some experts have doubts.
I think if there's one thing that defines humans, it's our ability to twist the environment to suit ourselves.
This is Jason Razgon. In his home workshop, he's got a knack for repairing vintage pocket watches. In the lab, Jason studies mosquitoes and the diseases they carry. When the World Mosquito Program first showed that Wolbachia could block dengue transmission, he was intrigued.
And since we'd been working on Wolbachia for a long time, we'd been working on West Nile for a long time, it seems sort of a natural thing to kind of put those two questions together. We were basically, honestly, trying to jump on the bandwagon.
Jason was working with Culex tarsalis, a mosquito known for carrying West Nile virus.
We developed techniques to artificially infect that particular mosquito with Wolbachia. When we did that, we found something a little unexpected. The mosquitoes that were infected with Wolbachia actually had a greater probability of becoming infected with West Nile. So it actually increased their susceptibility to virus.
Jason and other researchers dug deeper and found that Wolbachia could affect mosquito-borne viruses in a variety of ways.
You can have highly variable results depending on what mosquito or what arthropod you're talking about, what Wolbachia strain you're talking about, what pathogen you're talking about, variation in environmental factors, such as temperature, relative humidity.
In other words, there are a lot of factors at work and a lot of opportunities for those factors to interact in ways we can't easily predict.
You can have a particular Wolbachia strain in a particular mosquito that actually blocks one pathogen, but might have no effect on a different pathogen or even the opposite effect on a different pathogen. And so those are the kind of things that concern me a little bit when these things are being released into natural populations.
And as someone who likes to understand how things work, Jason has another concern.
We still don't really have a good handle on what the actual mechanism of how Wolbachia blocks pathogens in mosquitoes.
He's worried that we might not know enough to intervene or even recognize if something's gone wrong.
Now, it should be said, not everyone shares Jason's reservations, but his concerns do illustrate why communities should approach these solutions with eyes wide open. That's something Jason says the World Mosquito Program does really well.
The public engagement and the public participation was never done as an afterthought, was baked into the very foundation of the project from the very, very beginning. I think that's a model for how these things need to be done. So while I might not agree with every sort of technical decision that they make, I really want these things to work. These are devastating diseases. They affect, you know, billions of people.
I think whenever we're faced with a huge problem, we always have to balance two things, knowledge and action. And sometimes it's very difficult to know, you know, when it's time for knowledge and when it's time for action.
This approach to fighting mosquito-borne disease is pretty new, but the concept of biocontrol, using one species to control another, has a deep history that includes both resounding successes and infamous missteps. In a weird coincidence, the very first place these Wolbachia-infected mosquitoes were released was in northern Queensland, the epicenter of the world's most notorious biocontrol disaster. The cane toad, brought to Australia to eat sugarcane pests, was both a biocontrol failure and an ecological catastrophe, spreading across the continent and devastating native ecosystems.
In terms of biological control itself, it has deep ethical implications. And we have seen in the past, there are numerous examples of how it can result in unforeseen consequences.
Nelson and his colleagues don't take their work lightly, but they think the benefits of controlling dengue outweigh the risks.
In the city we are right now, we have around 2,300 cases this year. One of the lowest incidents in the country. I think what we're doing is the right thing.
And communities around the world seem to agree. Thanks for watching, everybody. I'm excited to tell you about something special. I recently teamed up with PBS and the BBC to bring you Walking with Dinosaurs Unearthed. Click the link on screen or below to watch the latest episode and tell them Human Footprint sent you.